country and such a wonderful, fun, and hip place to be. So I just want to thank you for taking your time this evening. My name is Nancy Klein. I'm the Director of Real Estate for the City of San Jose. I've had the good fortune to know many of you over the, now this is the 112th meeting on the project, over time, that spans many years. But that's an accurate count. And I wanted to let you know that the purpose of tonight's evening is to really hear about the steps of concept of design that we promised, the team promised we would be back to you. And so the team has been busily doing its work and want to share, and most importantly, to get your input and your thoughts into the process. So again, thank you for being here. And I wanted to ask Councilmember Raul Perales to come say welcome. We're very lucky that he is here as well. And Councilmember Perales.
Thank you. Thank you very much and good evening. I'm here really on two parts. I'm here just like you as a constituent, a concerned community member, and very excited community member about what's going to be happening here at the Old Courtyard. And certainly I've picked up the baton sort of on the last leg, if you will, hopefully the last leg, from a project that we know that this community has been waiting for a really, really long time. I'm very excited about it. I'm looking forward to the full presentation tonight as well. And my office is going to be here to the end to make sure that we're working with you, that the community's voice is heard on this. And we're really excited about the project. And I want to say thank you to everybody again for coming out and for your participation on this. So I don't know who's next.
And I am the planning project manager. I am the newbie. I know many of you have probably been to all those 112 meetings, so thank you for coming to my first meeting. Tonight, I want to remind you to make sure you sign in the back. I also have an agenda, so I hope you had a chance to pick that up. I'm going to run through it really quickly with you. First, we did some welcomes. Then I'm going to run through where we are in the planning process. Since there have been 112 meetings, I want to kind of regroup you and tell you where we are and where we're going to be. Then we're going to have the project team come up. They're going to give you a description of the project. And then we're going to kind of do a recap, do some next steps. And then we're going to have an open forum where you're going to get a chance to ask your questions. And then after that, we're going to have some public works staff come up and give a brief discussion about what's to come related to protected intersections. That's going to be a separate meeting. So what really they're here to do is just give you a sneak peek to what's to come. So where are we in the planning process? As Nancy mentioned, we've had 112, I call them pre-meetings, and then they've all led up to today. We have a zoning application on file. A zoning application kind of describes how the land is going to be used for. We're assessing what the land is going to be entitled for. So once we do that, then you have the PD permit process. That will come later, probably 4 or 5 months from now, where we talk about what's going to be built there. So really what we're talking about tonight is just how the land can be used. In order to approve a zoning entitlement, first you go to Planning Commission, which we think might be roughly around October 7th. And then after Planning Commission, a zoning goes to City Council. So it's a recommendation of approval or denial by the Planning Commission to City Council. That'll be roughly in November. And then a zoning takes effect about a month after whatever decision, if it's approved. So that's where we're at right now. We're just going to discuss the way the land can be used tonight and want to present that concept to you. To do that, we have three people here tonight. We have Matt Brown with Williams & Bain. We have Ken Kay with Ken Kay Landscape Architecture. And we have Connie Martinez from the SV Creates. And so they're going to talk about different aspects of the project. Matt's going to go through how the design has evolved over those 112 meetings. Ken Kay's going to talk about the urban space, kind of how he's taken the ideas over the last 112 meetings and turned it into something, some kind of project. And then Connie's going to talk about the anticipated CCA building. So with that, I'll turn it over to Matt.
Can you put all the names that you said up on the screen so we can see
them
officially? Like your name and her name, the three names of people you said?
My name is on the agenda, and also I have cards in the back, so my name is not up there, but it'll go up on a website, and then everybody who talked tonight will be on that website as well.
Sure.
Okay, thank you, Leah. It's good to be back here in Japantown. I think most of you know, my name is Matt Brown. I'm with Williams & Dang. We've been working here in Japantown since 2007 on this project, and with a little hiccup of a certain economic downturn in between then and now, we're really happy and excited to be back here tonight to talk a little bit about what we're doing. As Leah mentioned, our focus tonight is not so much on the specific architecture because we're still early in the design process. Our focus really is on, in general, how are we planning on approaching the design of the project, the development of the site, and what is it going to feel and look like as a person walking around and through the site as you see that in the future. So I want to just point out a couple of people who are here with us tonight, of course, with related, our partners on the project, Susan Smart and Matt Piper. We have Ken Kay and his team with the landscape architects, Jason Roberts with Acre Moisten, the architects on the project. So we're all here tonight and available to answer any of your questions afterwards. So next, please. So where we've been, again, like I mentioned, we've been here for a while working on this project. Originally had a EIR certified for the site back in 2008 with a program, as you can see there, of up to 600 units, a new home for Tyco, commercial, very similar to what we're looking at today. In 2013, we executed a letter of intent with the city to again proceed with some of our pre-development planning. And in 2014, we had an update to the EIR certified and also entered into a purchase and sale agreement with the city of San Jose for the property. Now, since that time, since December, you may ask, where have we been and what have we been up to? We've actually spent a good amount of the last 7 or 8 months focusing on what I would call due diligence, but especially a lot of investigation into the site or the environmental conditions, really getting comfortable with the ability to proceed with development on the site. So a lot of that work has been going on, and we're now at that point in the process where we said we'd want to start talking to the community about how the project's going to look and feel and begin getting your ideas about that. Next. So we've heard a lot of different things over the past few years. This is just a short list of some of the things we've heard, ranging from how it's important that we reflect the unique setting of the site, both culturally and historically, that San Jose Tyco is an absolutely critical part of this, that having a permanent home for them here in Japantown is important, that we should have great open space and connections to and through the site. So you can kind of go through and see some of those things that we've been hearing. A couple things that I know that we're going to, I'm sure, talk about tonight. You know, parking in the neighborhood and around in the business area. And I think there's really two issues to look at on that. One, are we doing a responsible job of parking the new development on the site? And then two, I know that there's issues that are probably beyond this development proposal about just parking in general in Japantown and how that's handled. Next. We've held probably the same development principles from the outset of this, and I think we continue to hear from people that these are the right things to continue to emphasize on the site. So just to run through these briefly, getting the first 30 feet right means we're going to create a great pedestrian environment around the building. We think all those details that go into the first 30 feet of development are the difference between making a great place for people and making a not so great place for people. So we want to focus on getting those details right. Connections to and through the site. This is not going to be a full block development that's walled off. We want people to get into and through and around the site. So very different maybe than some other developments that you see around this area. The unique sense of place that reflects, you know, our location in Japantown, which is a unique neighborhood, not just in San Jose, but in California and in the West Coast. Diverse and complementary retail mix. So we want to make sure that we're complementing the existing Japantown retail environment and not competing with or doing something that clashes with that environment. Talked about a permanent home for San Jose Tyco, again, is critical. And then high quality design throughout, which I'll talk about and Ken will talk about in a little bit. Next. So where are we at today in terms of our program? About 532 residential units between two buildings, in the north building, again about 238, and then, or 294 in the south building, about 238, up to about 20,000 square feet of new local retail and commercial. That's primarily all located within the south building, so along Jackson Street and 6th. The CCA, the Creative Center for the Arts, that Connie will talk about here in a few minutes, is up to 60,000 square feet of new arts-related spaces, including a permanent home for Tycho. Parking, we'll have about 827 total spaces on the site. What that means is that the development is entirely self-parked. About 1.4 spaces per residential unit, consistent with what city code requires and what other people have been building and development like this. 40 spaces for retail and some spaces as well for CCA. And then last, about 3/4 acre public plaza and park, and that's going to be designed again in cooperation with the community and through a good community discussion, be developed and delivered as part of the first phase of development. Okay, next. So conceptually, this diagram is going to look very familiar to people who have been attending these meetings for a long time. And essentially what we have is Taylor Street on the left, Jackson Street on the right, 7th above and 6th below. The idea is two buildings that surround and encompass the park and the CCA in the middle of the site. So one of the things that we really want to do is, as you know, we think about the connections down to the Jackson Street retail corridor and coming up and really kind of making a statement at that 6th and Jackson corner, but also drawing people up 6th into the site and again through the site. So you'll have the ability to walk through the park, around the CCA, out to 7th, and on through the neighborhood. So it really kind of breaks down the scale of this block and invites people into and through the site. Next. I just want to give you a little bit of a sense, too, of how our architectural team has started thinking about approaching the design. We've talked in the past about the need to have the architecture kind of reflect its unique place in Japantown. So, as an example, when we look at the diagram of the site up here on the upper right, there's kind of these two buildings on either side. They thought about it as, well, you know, how would you arrange these buildings in a way that made sense? Is it kind of like an arrangement of tatami mats in a pinwheel, which would be a traditional way of arranging these mats within a Japanese space? Or if you look at how the design for these buildings begin to play out with tansu, which is the concept of cabinetry design, and where you're looking at corners and forms and how these masses kind of fit together, or shoji with screens and how you can layer these different forms. And this isn't, you know, going to directly, you know, translate into a building that looks like it has, you know, traditional Japanese screens, but it's a way of kind of thinking about how you approach the design of the buildings, and if you really kind of think and look about it and look at the buildings, that there's some sense that there's a relationship back to its special location here in Japantown. So, let me see, with that, I think I've talked fast enough and long enough that I should probably hand it over to Ken, who's going to walk you through some other elements of the project.
Thank you very much, Matt. Good evening, everybody. I thank you for coming to the meeting this evening, and as mentioned, this is my first time at the rodeo, and so what you're going to see this evening is I'm focusing on really the public realm. So the public realm is defined as anything outside your front door, basically, but I'm going to take the footprints of these buildings and the opportunity for the Plaza Park, and we're calling it Plaza Park because we're trying to not think of this as kind of a traditional lawn kind of park. We're thinking of this more as an opportunity to have a farmer's market, to have events, to have things on event day, but also to make it very intimate and very comfortable on a day like this morning when there's maybe 5 or 6 of us sitting around the plaza. So we're going to do that, and the real important thing too is to integrate this design very closely with the CCA building. This is a great opportunity and a great marriage to make this an active place, a big part of the community, and it's going to be something that's going to be known throughout the city of San Jose. It's going to be something very, very special. So this evening, as a landscape architect and a planner, and Matt covered some of this in his conversation, but there are three principles that we basically work with. The principle of place making is important. I can simply put my definition to you as place making is, you know when you've arrived someplace, you know when you're there, and you know when you left. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at the heritage of the place. We're going to look at what makes good design and what would fit into Japantown. The first is really nature and details. And we all know Cherry Festival, we all know bamboo, the details, that we have to focus on both. We have to put ourselves in nature that has to surround us, but we need to focus on the details and the attention that you would pay, not in your car, but on your 2 feet walking around. And discovery and the way we do this will be very important. Also, all the seasonal quality. The other part of this is to discuss with you all tonight is really, are we going to look at this, what I think we are, as a contemporary design? For instance, in San Francisco, they have a very old-fashioned, very much a stone kind of concept that, and I've been there quite a few times, that it's not that usable. It doesn't have a lot of shade, which we're going to need here, but it's symbolic of what they design. We're not going to copy that. We're not going to copy any other place. We need to come up with our own concept for this place. The other opportunity here is really, in terms of placemaking, is have special events. The farmer's market, this will be a place for the farmer's market. This will be a permanent place. It will be one of those places that people will come to, enjoy, but also having the taiko drum here as part of the tennis and the CCA building is a really special thing. So I'm sure there's going to be events, there's going to be special times when the drums come out, and there's going to be opportunity to interact with that. Place marking, what is that? Place marking is objects in space that help you to wayfind where you're going. For instance, public art is very important for this project. You have some great artists in your community that I have had a chance to meet, and hopefully those people can be engaged in this. But we're looking at some rather tall sculptures to attract your attention from Jackson Street down 6th Street. So when you're on the corner, if you're a visitor, you can look down and say, oh, something down there, I want to check it out. Or there could be something like this stone sculpture that's here. These stone benches are very small, and also temporary art. The ability of artists to kind of paint on maybe pavement and then it goes away, but it's part of an event. The other part of this is to have objects that are identifiable. This happens to be in Barcelona, Spain, but it shows that you could sort of spell out a square in letters or something, and that would be a memorable thing. The other thing is having very unique furniture. We want to make sure that this place is comfortable, that for groups, for individuals, and we want to make sure there's a vocabulary of details to seem like it fit here. The architecture has wood on it. I think wood benches, things like that would be good. Maintenance is a big part of this, and also activation of the space is important. Now, the last one is the most important, and it particularly relates to your community. Place keeping means that there's a soul here, that there's a spirit. And that spirit is shown in Jackson Street and everything I've seen here. The shops I visited, people I've met, and we want to keep that. We want to extend it, and we want to make sure it's preserved. Next slide. So here's a diagram, and this is a plan view. This means you're looking down like from the air. So here's Jackson Street. This is North 6th Street, North 7th Street, and then here's East Taylor. Now what Matt said, which is very important, is that this is a big, long site, and sometimes you see big developments that look big. This project is broken down, this development, into three distinctive blocks. This is the block which is the residential and the retail. This is the block that has a CCA building, has a plaza and park, and this is the block that has just residential here. And the public realm would be all of the streetscapes, which I'll talk about, to go around the building. And the plaza and the park in the CCA building are separate parcels. They have separate processes, but it's being designed as one place. That's the main thing. Yes. So here's the conceptual design. You have to love the heart. But the heart of the project here is really the main plaza. And then the streetscapes, which I'll talk about separately, but I want to talk about this in particular. So we want to have a space that's big enough to hold maybe 700 people, maybe even 1,000 at one time. But we also want to make sure this space is comfortable, make sure it's inviting, and make sure it's special. So there's a series of outdoor gardens that have to be programmed and have to be designed. We have one which we call outdoor eating garden, which would be not necessarily a restaurant, which there probably will be one in this corner, but it will be a place where you can get your sushi or you can get something downtown, bring it over, sit on a rock, sit on a bench, enjoy it as you're going through. Passive recreation garden, that would be for Tai Chi, it would be for events, maybe yoga, things like that, that would be there, comfortable environment. And then a sculpture garden, and this view right here is really important, so we place kind of a sculptural element right there. And then a shade garden, which is very important, obviously, in a community like San Jose, where it is hot. And so the exposure, so this is also south exposure. This is the very rough diagram that the CCA building has put together. And there's a series of different functions or wings that are going to be created around a courtyard or a special place. And so we don't have a definitive design of this, but what we do know is that the heart has to touch the center. So that's kind of going to be the concept. Why don't we go to the next one, Sal? So if we take this and we talk about the streetscapes in particular, which are, there's a half a mile of streetscapes roughly, they go all the way around here. There's going to be a bulb out on this corner, which is, as Matt said, the first 30 feet are going to start right here on 6th, and you're going to see across to this little plaza. Now I have some renderings that were done by an artist that I'm going to show you. So I'm going to walk you through what it's like from here to being on 6th Street, looking down to the plaza, in the plaza, both on a Monday morning and also during that day. And then I'm going to show you kind of a green wall against this side of the development. But one of the concepts with this red line is very much harking back to really your culture, and also not only the artifacts that were found on the site, but also to the local artists that have, that should be celebrated in some way. So we see these squares, Tanami squares, being placed in the concrete at these entrances and all the way down the street to this end. And they will have Ken's in the audience. So Ken's, one of Ken's pieces might be in here. Also, we have some site artifacts from the Japanese American Museum, which could be in here too. They're not going to be physically in there. They're going to be images of it. They're put into a metal plate. The brick is significant because Hyattville was built of brick after it was burnt down so many times. So the brick kind of recalls the history of when the Chinese were here at that time. So these will be along here. Here's an example of the sidewalk, which is 15 feet wide, and how each one of those lay out. So they're not in every square, but there's a sequence of them. The other part of this is that we're also going to make this an iPhone app. I have to bring it to the 21st century, where, like when you go to a museum, you put on earphones and it tells you really what you're seeing. So we're hoping that we can do that on the site. So it can explain the artists that are there, or it can explain the artifacts and where they were found. The other parts of this is there are trees all around the site, mostly sweet gum and Australian willows. They, as a landscape architect, they look a little undernourished and a little bit like they need to be pruned up and looked after their health. So first thing we're going to do is we're going to look at all the trees. We want to preserve as many as we can. We want to make sure that they're in good condition, so they're safe, but also look good. And they might have to be replaced with other trees, which are not necessarily bad, but we'll look at those. Also, we're going to take all the vocabulary details on Jackson Street. We're basically going to extend those down, the banners, the poles, and we're going to pay attention to details, like even the manhole. We're also going to, on 6th Street, we're going to celebrate it by putting these kind of planting areas where the trees are as well. So it's going to be distinctive than the other streets. Next. Okay, ready for the walk? So here we are, first 30 feet. So you're standing here. That's Jackson, 6th Street. So you're going to be looking across the street, and there's going to be people eating out here, which you'll see in the next image. But what we're trying to do is soften this whole corner by putting, basically putting a low wall in here with some benches in the back, which might be black granite, for instance, to match the benches. We're going to put planting at the base, a little bit of planting here, so it kind of buffers you when you're in the space from the cars. And then you're going to see the vocabulary details of Jackson go all the way up the street. Next. Okay, so we're on the sidewalk and we're heading down to the square. So here we are. So you see the cafe, people eating. You see planters with in pots, benches for people to sit, the banners. You see the tatami sculpture, medallions, I'll call it here. But you also see sculpture in the background, something that's an eye catcher. Now, Susan from Related is my client, and she told me that maybe I made this a little too big. But that's going to have to be determined when we actually get down to it. But we need something that sparkles. We need like an eye catcher. Yeah. But this is, and then there's planting also at the top. The other part of this is the glass is receding. So it's nice because it doesn't feel like the building is coming right out to the street. There's a little bit of room, so you feel like it's a little wider. Okay, next. Now, this is the park. This is the first opportunity that we've had to do this. We're going to work on this. But it's fairly big. There's a lot of paving. So we're looking at how to make the center of this connect to the CCA building in the back, how to make that work, and how to create these spaces a little bit softer on the edges, on these four edges. Now, that's not in the rendering, but I'm just letting you know it's a big space and there's plenty of opportunity to do different things. And I'm hoping we'll get some feedback today about what you all think could fit in those spaces. Thank you. So here's event day. So we need to make the space big enough where we can put tents and various things that happen on event day in the space. And we have to make sure that we have enough room, but we want to make sure it's soft enough. Next cell. Okay, this is a green wall. This happens to be a step. It's not going to be a public access, but it's going to be for the residents coming down into the space. This is on the north side of the plaza. So there'll be chances to sit here and look back out, but it'll be a green wall, and it will have all the seasonal color, like cherry trees and have bamboo and various other things. Okay, next. So here's the size of it all. It's big. The space is as big as Union Square in San Francisco. Not the whole thing, but the center part, which is here, which is good, but it doesn't need to look like Union Square. It doesn't need to be paved like that. So the trick is, for us, is to come up with a way to kind of get enough space where it's hardscape, but get other space where it is softer, like decomposed granite and planting. We're not anticipating a lot of lawn, if any, in this, particularly in the drought. We're looking at places for people to sit and have activities and to be part of this. Sell next. So here's the diagram that I showed you. So here's the heart. Here's the CCA building up here. So here's what we need to think of as maybe a little harder scape, and it would be permeable material like bricks. Here's the outdoor eating. Here's the passive recreation, shade garden, sculpture garden. So this might be the heart of it. It's about this big, not that big. Okay, next. All right, so the first diagram that was done of a design, which needs to be really refined, particularly after this meeting, was to have these radial arms that embrace the CCA in the center of the CCA, come back out to where the sculpture is. It has a series of rock formations that you can sit on. It has bike sharing that would be in this corner here. And then would have the opportunity to have some objects in the center of this to soften it up and to be able to sit and actually focus in on the CCA area in terms of what we're doing. The other part of this, with the CCA, they're proposed these two trellises that can be done by an artist and some planting that would buffer the sides of these, because there's different uses in that building that don't necessarily have windows on every side. So I want to make sure the interface between the residential and the building really work together and is comfortable and compatible with the plaza that we're designing. Here's the market space. Here's the sculpture, different scales and sizes. This is the outdoor eating area that can be done with benches or with rocks. And then here's the passive recreation areas that are represented in each one of these. Next. So here's another shot at it, which talks about some of the paving. We want to make sure that a lot of this has water goes through, because we're trying to get to the water table. We can soften it with like slime, like we've done here. We can put sculpture in it, like a computer sort of thing. We want to make sure that the planting and for shade is important, but also for water conservation. We're really in a period of time right now in California, but we have to set an example of how to do planting that doesn't look like it's going to be out of date or take too much water. The other part of this is the trellis possibilities, planting, and then the activities, whether it's, you know, the market or it's going to be a play or whatever. But we also want to make sure that people have an opportunity to do their computer stuff, you might say, like with steps and amphitheater stuff. Next. Okay, now I'm going to introduce Connie Martinez, but I would like to thank my staff, Salvador, Elizabeth, Jason. Can you stand up just? Thank you for your time, and I probably talked longer than I had the time for, Leah, but I wanted to take my time to make sure you understood we're sincerely interested in making this work.
Thank you, Ken. Good evening, everyone. As I was introduced as Connie Martinez, I'm also the head of SD Creates, and I'm representing our team who's been working on the Creative Center for the Arts. That includes the core team members, of course, are San Jose Tyco, Lisa, where are you? Lisa, there you are. And Roy Hirabayashi. Okay, there's Roy. And Suzanne Z. John Gray, Crepe TV. And Alexander Urbanowski with SB Creates. And our architect, who's with Anchor Moisson, Jason Roberts. So that's our team that's been working on this. Just a little bit of history for those of you who don't know about the Creative Center for the Arts. This has been a conversation that's been going on in the arts community for well over 10 years. So we are a group of civic and cultural leaders who care about our community, care about the arts and culture ecosystem. And with this opportunity in Japantown, we certainly want to make Japantown proud of the Creative Center for the Arts and grow into our aspirations of becoming a place for creativity to thrive and for the arts community to have spaces and resources and for the community to participate with us. So my first slide is going to capture some of what we're thinking in terms of the soul. Ken, you mentioned the soul of Japantown. What is the soul of the Creative Center for the Arts? The three words that we came up with were creativity, engagement, and community. So the visuals are those that we carefully selected that felt like the kind of place we want to be part of and the kind of work we want to do inside the Creative Center for the Arts. So this is for the makers of the arts and the administrative offices and the infrastructure behind the creative activities that serve our city and our region. But when all is said and done, it's about the people and the organizations that will live inside of it and how we will interact with the community that we're in. So this was the sort of slide to show the soul. And then the next slide is to show the kind of design concepts that we want to bring to the physical building, and that is iconic architecture. We care deeply about the expression of the architecture and the patterning, the light, everything, so that will when you turn that corner and you've seen that big sculpture, you will just be drawn into this beautiful space, and that it really does reflect the creative community that's here. Then next slide, Ken said that we are, maybe it was Matt, you said that we were in the very early stages. We don't have design concepts, we don't have designs to show you. But what we do want to say is that we're seeing this as a building that has multiple levels, and that there's something where the park, the integration of the park, is so much part of what our design is. In fact, could you go back to the slide before, because I didn't go to those 2 second concepts. Design quality, the texture, the rhythm, the simplicity that fits with this, the architecture, but the integration of the park. This is our opportunity to actually be literally part of the park as we build this, so that the physical design of the building is integrated with the park plaza. And so, back to the next slide, is so that we're, as you see this, as Ken described, the heart, that we're essentially that you know, being away from that hurt, and that our design will draw the community in, and they will be a place where artists and organizations and art-serving organizations can thrive. Our motivation was to find these spaces for the arts community, but also to create spaces that where collaboration thrives and the synergies of our ecosystem are realized, and that we become part of the transformation of this space, and that we become part of this community. So the folks that are leading this, our motivations are that we love this community, we love the arts, and we want to be part of this phenomenal project. So very excited to be here, very excited to be working with Ken and his team, who, by the way, I've worked with for over 10 years, which is wonderful. And back when I was at the Children's Discovery Museum, way back when we started thinking about designs in downtown, Ken was part of that conversation. So it's great to have you back, and then Matt and Related. So we're very appreciative to Related, who's been very generous with our efforts as we're planning. And with that, I'm gonna turn it back to Matt.
So before I hand it back over to Leah to kind of run the rest of the meeting here, I do want to point out that we have a website, as we promised we would when we got to this. Welcome, Tina. Anyway, JapantownSquare.com should be easy for you to remember and get in there. Now, just keep in mind, you know, we have Japantown Square all over this. You know, we still have a lot of time in front of us as well in terms of figuring out what the proper names are for the project and everything else. But want something easy to remember for now that kind of reflects the thinking behind the project. You'll find my contact information on there, as well as Leah's, as well as links to all of our project partners' websites, so you'll be able to see who we are and what we're up to. So we'll keep that updated, newsletters, new information, things like that as you go, and there's an opt-in sign up on that website as well, so you can be automatically notified when there's new content. All right, so with that, I'm gonna hand it over to Leah. Thanks.
Thank you, everybody. So I'm going to do a quick recap because we saw some great photos, but I want to do the not fun stuff. It's the nitty-gritty of the project. What is the applicant asking for? If you look at the top of your agenda, we have a project description. Ultimately, this applicant is asking to build up to 600 units, up to 25,000 square feet of commercial space, and they want to include a private community center. So when we're talking about the zoning, all of the pictures that you saw that will be inside this buildable envelope. It'll be less units, as Matt talked about, but there's that fluctuation just in case. It may not be 25,000 square feet of retail, but there's that is the cap. It wouldn't be any more. So first you have to zone the land. You have to get approval for that buildable envelope. That's what's happening right now. It's just the zoning. We're going to go to Planning Commission first with this project, and then you go to City Council. Planning Commission will be roughly around October 7th, and then a month later you'll go to City Council. After that process is closed, depending approval or denial, let's anticipate approval just for now, we would have the PD permit process. That's when we're talking about the actual buildings, the actual location of the park, of the CCA. All those things will have been set in stone, and we'll come back to you either in one or two meetings to discuss the more concrete design of the project, of the CCA building. And we're also going to talk more about protected intersections, which Karen is going to touch on briefly after we turn it over to you for questions. So what we're going to do now is, if you have a question, we're going to have you answer it. If it's a city question, I can answer it. I also have a real baby here with planning. She's going to be taking down notes. And then if it's a design question or a CCA question, I'll turn to Ken or Matt or Connie. Okay? So we'll start. First question.
Nobody's mentioned height. You know, and that was a big issue with the previous planning board. Started 5 or 6 stories, then worked up to 13. I was thinking a month or 2 months ago, they said, well, it's going to be 5 or 6 stories. But it seemed to be kind of, nobody's made any mention tonight. I was wondering what the current plan is.
That would have been good for me to put on the slide, I think. 6 stories is what is the height that we're looking at, which is fairly consistent with what we had talked about before.
Right.
Yeah.
Parking is always an issue. Well, what about the parking facilities, not only for the residents, the merchants, but also the visitors in the Japan Park?
So parking, as a city, we can only require that a use parks itself. So we require that the developer park its residential uses, they're parking the commercial space, and they're parking the CCA building. There will be parking along the side streets. But beyond that, it's hard for the city to condition extra parking. So we require that they park their uses on site. The streets, the street frontages will have street parking. And beyond that, it'll just be what's available on the street. Yes, sir.
By the way, really, it's a great development. You should be mentioned. It's beautiful. However, 1.4 spaces per tenant, are they only allowed 1.4 cars each? Parking is already difficult at lunchtime. Evening, I don't understand how that can suffice.
You and me both. The parking calculations for the zoning code is an interesting calculation. I couldn't tell you the origin of that, but it works out to, we take that number 1.4 times X amount of units. Whatever the number is, we always round up. So really, a 1.4 space, let's say there was only one unit, it would end up to be two. It doesn't work out to be two per space, but with the round, whatever the ultimate unit count would be, the parking is roughly enough for at least one car per unit, and might even be extra.
I think one of the things we've talked about in the parking ratios all along has been that it also depends on the mix of units that are in the building. So there will be a number of, for instance, studio and one bedroom units in the building. A lot of those will come with maybe just one car. Some of those people may have no cars, right? There are people that will bike, walk, use transit. And when you look at the demographics of people that are living in some of these more urban areas like this and in a project like this, there are a number of people coming to these projects without cars. I'm not saying that's all of them, right? I'm not saying it's even a substantial majority, but there will be some people that could do that. So when you look at the mix of units, studios, one bedrooms, two bedrooms, and a few three bedrooms, right? Overwhelmingly, we believe that that 1.4 spaces per unit will serve those adequately without forcing a lot of that parking out onto the street. So it's very consistent too with what the market is doing everywhere in San Jose in terms of the parking for a development of this type.
So the majority is one bedroom then, or studios?
Specifically, I believe, Matt, it's about 30% two and three bedrooms, and 70% would be one bedroom and studios. That's right. So I'll just answer it very simply this way. Structured parking is expensive, right? And if you had to build three spaces for a three bedroom, two spaces for a two bedroom, and two spaces for a one bedroom, we'd be looking at a vacant parking lot for the next 30 years. Okay, so there's a very basic economic concept at work here, which is that, you know, we build as much structured parking as you need to serve the development, okay? Further, what we're seeing is that, again, a lot of these one-bedroom studios will come with one car. That leaves the 0.4 to share with the other two-bedroom and three-bedroom units where they're coming with more. We may even get to a point, too, where we can, find ways to encourage people to use other forms of getting around. You know, we're including in this project, for instance, a lot of covered and structured bike parking, spaces for car shares, right, that will allow people to use some other means so that if you think about it, where a lot of these people are living in developments of this type, if they can get away with owning one car and then finding another alternative that gets them around, you know, in the other times when they need that second car, that translates into them wanting to live in that location and being able to live in that location. So there's a lot of different things based on our experience developing in a lot of different areas that demonstrate that this kind of parking ratio works without having that parking spill out to the neighborhood around.
So Will's noted on the board that parking is a concern. I want to make sure we get every kind of issue addressed. So if we could move on from the parking, maybe to a different topic.
So. I want to add that the parking is something you guys completely missed. You're talking tenant. You're looking at it from a perspective of tenant and availability for tenant parking. So we talk about guests. But you have Ethiopian Orthodox Church right here on 6th, and down the street you have Church of God, COID, yeah, the prayer garden. And I don't know how many people they have in their congregation, but we probably have a couple. I know the Ethiopian church, they have a couple hundred. I see these people walking from another time zone already to go to their services. And I visit the prayer garden, and I know that if you have events going on, non-tenants are going to be coming there and getting their spaces. And you have these people that come on Sunday that, where are they going to park, you know? And then not just Sunday, but I know the prayer garden, they have things going on. They have Tuesday night things and Thursday night things. And so I don't forget to consider the impact of what already exists. And, you know, instead of, you know, I would hope that somebody wouldn't just take the numbers that somebody crunched over here and completely neglect other issues like visitors.
A lot of these buildings are older buildings. For example, the church across the street from the site is a legal non-conforming use. They don't provide the parking they as an organization should provide because the structure was there, I think, 70 or odd years ago. We didn't have parking requirements. So it's difficult to impose on applicants other projects' responsibility related to parking. So as a city, you can only condition something that you have a legal nexus for, and this project is providing the parking that the city requires. Parking is an ongoing problem in a city with a million people, and we just try to encourage as new development comes along, they park their use. We can't restrict the number of cars people bring in a family, so we can only do parking adjustments based as projects that don't conform. As they redevelop, they'll have to conform to a standard as well. I'd like to take other questions besides parking for now, and if we have time, we will go back to parking, I promise.
Well, call your gendarmes off. It's a big revenue producer for the city already. We can't afford any more of these gigantic tickets, $400 tickets.
Ma'am in the back.
Yeah, so I have a couple of thoughts, and because the subject of parking has come up, it would be great if the city would come up with some good alternative means of public transportation, community buses, you know, things that will encourage people to use alternate forms of transportation. Because as it is, even with the 532 units, that's 745 more cars on the road, you know, in this small neighborhood. So I don't know that it's within the scope of this particular project, but I think it needs to be a discussion that happens in tandem, because it's really important that people, you know, start, you know, taking public transportation or, you know, car sharing or, you know, bike sharing or carpooling, whatever it is.
Agreed, and the city's general plan, the 2040 general plan, has a whole chapter dedicated to ways the city hopes to get people out of their cars. We can't make people do things, but we definitely, as a city, promote those values. There's going to be improvements to the streets, which we'll talk about, that you can choose to maybe make places more bike-friendly, pedestrian-friendly. There's all the general plan is focused on getting people to be ped, bike, and out of their cars. And we can just hope that, you know, in the next 10 years, we see some improvements. There are improvements to light rail coming down the line, and the city is dedicated to doing that. And will it happen with this one project? No, but over time it will. And with public places like the park, with the farmers market, with the CCA, in a dense area, we will get people out of their cars and walking and on bikes to go to places like that. In the back.
Thank you. You know, everybody knows about the cars and transportation, and I'm sure it's very important for the cars to be involved and having up space. What about the units, the amenities of the units, and how this project is going to be a little bit different or unique among its competition or in the surrounding area? We have a very, you know, competitive reach, you know, that own buildings just a couple blocks down, like, you know, Essex Property Trust, and then we have Fairfield. How is this this complex and its amenities a little bit different than the rest of the competition around?
I'm going to say the first and foremost thing that differentiates this project from anything else that's out there is where it is. So first and foremost, being located in a unique neighborhood like Japantown with a great urban environment and urban setting around it is very different than a lot of the new, you know, residential apartment development you see further north, right? Which is really just, you know, a lot of very similar kind of apartments, you know, one after another. In addition to that, though, I mean, we are looking at, you know, some great amenities within the buildings themselves. So I think, can you hit the next slide, Salvador? So even if you look at kind of these two buildings, you'll see that there's the big green box in the middle of these, right? These are courtyards, essentially, sit up at the second level. Amenity decks, you know, in the parlance of a developer. But essentially, these are places that we're providing some of the more private open space for the residents that live there. Could be a pool, some gathering places, picnic areas, things like that. So there's kind of a semi-private area that looks down on the park, and there's a connection to the park. And then you have the environment around the base of the building themselves, right? The units themselves are going to be, you know, I mean, Related does a great job with their development, right? They are, these buildings are intended to be LEED Silver, so they're gonna meet a very high environmental standard. Again, not something that you will see in a lot of other development around Silicon Valley. And then we're also looking at, you know, I'll go back and reiterate, but just to build on, the idea that you can walk out the front door of these units, walk to a number, you know, 40 different unique shops, right, that you won't find anywhere else in San Jose, walk half a mile to light rail, get on your bike and you're a mile to downtown. You know, the location of this is so well integrated into this area that it's really going to be attractive, I think, to the type of people that want to live in a connected area like that. Do you want something to say? So Susan wanted to point out too, I forgot to mention, we do have along the north building especially, the ground floor of that is residential, but they're actually going to be very stoop-like. So there's, you know, if you can imagine, you know, a couple steps up, kind of a semi-private entrance, a little bit of landscape buffer between that. So again, it's a very kind of urban and unique type of residential unit. And then also, just not even just the second floor, but also on the rooftop, we'll have some deck amenity space as well. So an opportunity for people to get up and have some common areas on the top of the buildings.
I just wanted to add really quickly, what's unique about this site is we have a development agreement between the developer and the city, because it's a city-owned property. The design standards for this, whether you want to call it amenity, it's a visual amenity, are very high, and the city has a lot of control at the plan development stage to ensure that the design is a quality design. It's not going to be one of those apartments that they start to finish, can put up in a month and slap up some stucco. It's going to be, it's, as you can see from the presentation, it's been well thought out, and we require that it be really thought out so that visually pleasing not only to the residents but the entire neighborhood. Sir Pat.
No, I'm a retired construction worker, and I'd like to know if you expect to be drawing the workers to construct this project from the local community, paying prevailing wages, minimum wages, and how long do you think it will take to construct this project?
So we will be hiring a contractor from the local area, from the Bay Area, to work on this. And of course, that comes with a lot of subcontractors, and usually the more local, the better, right? Because the less they have to travel, the better price they can give you on the project. So we do expect a lot of construction activity on this project. We anticipate starting probably somewhere around this time next year. It's going to be probably about 16 to 18 months per building, 18 to 20, somewhere in there. Let's call it 16 to 20 months per building. Still haven't decided whether they both go at once or whether there's kind of they're staggered in phases. Okay, these are going to be what we call 5-over-1 development, which means that there's 5 stories of wood frame development over a concrete podium. By definition, those cannot be prevailing wage projects, right? The cost for taking a framing project like that to prevailing wage would put you out of the market. You'd never be able to build it and make the rents that you need. But there will be a lot of work on the project that is done at those rates, just by definition, because of the type of work that's being done, the type of labors that you have on the project. They'll be paying out on your prevailing wage.
You guys have mentioned about parking structures just making it extremely ridiculously expensive to move forward with the project. How about existing land that the city already owns nearby, is that still the same? Would it be like, it would take forever? Or can you build from the ground up and use something that's just sitting there, not being used, vacant, to provide parking?
So it's a good question. One of the things that drives the cost of parking on a project like this, which in part is because of the way we're trying to develop the site, right, which is to keep the ground plane open and allow people to get to and through the site, create park space and everything else. We're building a layer of parking below grade, right, plus some structured parking above it. So in general, in the past when I've looked at general costs for parking for below grade, I would tell you that it's between $40,000 to $45,000 per space, right? For above grade, it's maybe $25,000 to $30,000, depending on the finish. And for a surface parking lot, maybe it's $9,000, right? So those are the costs you're dealing with. And I think one of the things that we always try to do is to say, okay, there's an additional cost we're taking on here, but the amenity that we're providing in return, right, is great. Now, by pushing parking underground and everything else, we're able to get ground floor retail, we're able to get a park on the site, we're able to accommodate the CCA. So there's a lot of other amenities that we're able to provide along with that. If you were to provide parking on another site, you'd probably build a fairly cheap, you know, just structured parking, but it also, you know, it wouldn't really work for the residential, to be honest. I mean, the parking for the residential needs to be on the same site as where the building is. And I think there's generally some problems with building standalone parking structures because they're not as. But I mean, are you talking about parking for you, or are you talking about parking
general,
for?
I mean, in general, it sounds like everybody needs right. parking. So
right. Right.
There's a vacant lot somewhere. Is what I'm saying.
You could always
city,
build.
Not
yeah.
You guys,
yeah.
The city can.
You
like,
could always build parking.
Move
on
forward
it.
And like plan ahead and be like, well, we're building this. Let's
sure.
build a parking lot. Too.
Sure. Yeah.
That's all I'm saying.
Yeah, it's always possible. I think. You know, parking structures in general tend to be kind of dead, right? But,
yeah, for sure.
But you'd want it to be well designed and things like that, for sure. Yeah.
Hi, Nancy again. I wanted to just touch on the notion of additional parking options. A couple different things. So the city doesn't own a lot of land. And in Japantown, we own very little land. But we do have a working group that had met once and will be meeting again, separate and apart from this effort, to look at how do we better utilize the resources in the area, thinking through with the property owners, as well as some initial great ideas that folks have had from making lighting sharper so people feel comfortable to be walking at night, to an idea of putting sensors in the ground with an app so people can identify where available parking spaces are. We've seen some of that happen to a very wide range of issues. So the city has allocated an additional $250,000, really in that effort to be directed through the community and different organizations, including the business district, will be working on convening to really think through how strategically to best share the parking that's here so that we can make what spaces there are available on the most efficient kind of way. And then what other kinds of creative ways can we think about to make parking that much more effective? And one thing that many of you know, just as an additional thing, that will also probably change a number of people's lives and behavior is that within a couple years, we'll have BART open, right? And working, it really is on time and on budget so far. So that will be at the end of 2017, beginning of 2018. So the biking connection and walking connection, because it's really not very far at all from you. So but I want you to know that the parking conversation we all recognize is an important one, and that we'll be thinking through more options beyond this project.
Thank you, Nancy. I kind of want to direct the conversation to the presentation you saw and see if anybody has any thoughts about the park. This is my chance to hear you and your chance to tell me in the back.
Yes, thank you. Initially, the plans that came out had the opening of the park and the plaza on 7th Street. And so now it is a concern that it is opening on 6th Street, which I foresee some issues that will come with that. And who is the city going to be responsible for planning events for the park? Who's going to be responsible for planning the CCA events and so forth? Because there, I do see issues that impact that planning events, since this is directly in front of our properties. So could someone share some light on that as to why it was the relocation of the park was?
Really quick, and then I'll turn it to Ken. The park will function like a public park, so it'll be when you go to the park's website and you pull up the website, you'll see Japantown Park, whatever it's going to be named. And it, you'll be able to rent space and use the park just the way you can use any other park. Parks and Recs will manage the park. It'll be a city-owned park. So any kind of issue that arises will be directed towards park. They'll be in charge of making sure that, you know, it's safe, and whatever Parks does, that, you know, that it'll be put towards that park. And then as far as the decision as to why they changed, I'll put that to Ken.
No, okay.
Yeah.
And then planning events, so the Sea Parks Recreation will handle the planning events.
We're going to have in our, but when we get closer to the PD stage, there will be a Parks representative who can speak more intelligently as to how the parks are planned. I'm sorry, I do not know exactly, but when events occur, there will be a contact person. As there, I believe there is now, when you went to the space at the park, correct?
We have a park
service. Oh, fabulous. Very good.
Good evening. My name is Mary Beth Harris. I'm interim deputy director with the Parks Department. And great question. We're focusing on activating a lot of our park spaces these days, so a real emphasis to getting events and things into parks. For this particular park, we have not confirmed how these events will be programmed or who specifically will be doing them as yet. Those are discussions that we're currently having with the developer. That's all I know today. Is there anything else to add on that from the developer?
Yeah. Well, I'd like to answer the question about why I think it's a better location than on 6th Street. Better on 6th than on 7th. First of all, we wanted to make sure that there was a good view from Jackson Street, that you were looking in to see the park like we're doing right here. I think that's, if the building was there, it would be the back of the building, which is, the back of the building now is going to be on 7th Street, which is really the service side of the development. This is where all the service is going to go in, people are going to drive in. This is the pedestrian side right here. Also, the light quality in that space is very important in terms of the park, in terms of people. And also, as we mentioned, the residents also have an opportunity to look down basically into the park and be part of it. So those are the reasons which I think make this a superior location than it was in the prior scheme. And I just recommended that as well, that it works this way.
Well, isn't there a pedestrian activity as well on the 7th? Now, there is a complex on the 7th Street as well.
Yes.
And so,
there's access. The thing is that
the residents are, would the residents be able to look down into the plaza from either block?
Well, it doesn't have the same exposure that it would, and also it would have to be serviced from 6th Street instead of 7th. And we're trying to make this permeable, as we talked about before, where it's really accessible all around here. So the people on 7th should take advantage of walking through that setting and coming into the park. That would be my reason. Okay.
I just wanted to add that I think what I hear, and tell me if I've got this right, we, whatever the final arrangements are, we need to make sure that this gets well coordinated with you and other key members. Totally understand that you're going to have Sunday morning services or other services, and it wouldn't be very conducive to service to maybe have Tyco performing at the same time you're having services. So the level of thought and care and concern that I'm hoping you're seeing is going into the project, while we can't give you a specific answer, the coordination will continue.
Exactly. And which means the farmers market is weak at the same time. So we have to take all of that into consideration. And so this comes as a surprise to see that the location was happening. We were not contacted as a neighbor directly across the street.
Understood. And that's in part now, we're thinking through the sun shade so that you didn't have the building mostly in shade and not a great usable space. And I think that's, Ken in Landscape Talk was actually sharing that information. But when you think about how the farmer's market would lay out, which probably will make sure it isn't as close even as they are now, because they're kind of on the same side.
No, but, they're not. They're on the opposite corner.
On the opposite corner.
And we won't, Jackson side.
We won't be able to solve right now because we don't know what the solution is.
Now, so that everyone has understanding that that is not acceptable. And so since we're in the community, because we're supposed to be working together.
Understood.
And have an understanding amongst all of the parties involved, that this is something that should definitely be taken into consideration, and that we should be contacted, as we have commercial property as well that is on 6, as well as the church. So in planning, this is well and good, it's beautiful, but how is this going to work out?
On all of that is very important that as you...
So when you the city of San Jose is involved with the Parks and Recreation, I have to make sure that it's understood tonight, Nancy, that we need to be contacted. And so when the plan came out and the relocation, if we receive an email, a phone call, or say, hey, this is what is proposed at this time. So this is a community meeting, and I'm voicing my concerns at this point on our behalf. So therefore, we do want to make sure that we are kept in the loop, and that somehow the coordination, I understand we're still in the early stages, you may not have the answer now, but please keep it in mind that it's going to be an issue.
Absolutely.
We do not want to have any issues. And so, yes, the developers and everyone that is in play with this new plan may see it as a great opportunity, great thing. I do see it, it's good, yes, but is it conducive for all?
And the devil's in the details. So we need to make sure we're coordinating. We very much hear you, project team, and we very much hear you.
Thank you.
We have about 5 more minutes before we have Public Works come up. So if we have somebody who hasn't asked a question yet, against the wall. They are going to build it to be usable in any way. They're not restricting it just to restaurants, just to retail. Susan, what happens when you start getting tenants, you hire someone who gauges the market. So Susan's going to make an informed decision as to what kind of tenant. They know that people want to walk. They've made a corner that's for eating, so there's likely to be a few restaurants. The space is going to be made so that it can be a viable. You're not going to have what we have downtown. Sometimes we have those storefronts that are too small and nobody wants to rent in them. They're going to be big, viable space, so you're going to get good quality tenants who can thrive in there and fill up that space and make it a very fun walkable street. Anybody else who hasn't asked a question?
Yeah, my question is about the when, I guess more for the city, when traffic studies are clear, figured out it's going to be more or new lights at the intersection of 6th and 3rd, because I can see it now. If the cars are exiting units are on 6th, trying to get onto Taylor, left, right, or cross, They're going to be delayed because the existing traffic is not, unless there's lights.
Can I table that question until Karen comes up? Because she's going to talk about the traffic briefly, and then in the back.
He's talking about traffic access to the 6th.
Sixth and Taylor, I just want to point out, I'm not sure if we were clear about this, but the entrances and exits to the parking garages are all on 7th. So we're expecting more of our traffic to be there. Of course, you have a signal at 7th and Taylor. And just real quick, also on your point about retail, local retail, you know, we're really looking at, again, a mix of retail tenants that are going to reinforce, right, kind of the mix that's there in Japantown. So, you know, we don't want to open up another Southern Chinese Noodle House right across from the one that's about to open, right? We want to find something that's kind of still unique and new, but is additive to the overall retail environment.
One last question. We'll take these last two.
So as far as the plaza and the park, just, you know, maybe this is discussion for, you know, further down, but I do have a concern on the drawings that I saw. There seems to be a lot of spaces that are not shaded where people are going to be eating or whatever, and so I think the idea that the trellises or some other kind of shade would be extremely helpful, especially during the day. Trees, of course, are always wonderful and appreciated. My concern is I would want to see something like the Parque de los Pobladores, which for quite a while the plaza sat empty and hot because it was way too hot. So it would be great to have those shade structures planned in.
And those are definitely things Ken is going to put in at the detail stage, but it's good to have those. Make sure that there's a lot of shade structure. We're also putting it on the board to take into account for the PD permit stage.
Yeah, just to be clear, there will be apartment units, not condos.
Yes, apartments, not condos. One more. Okay.
I just want to piggyback on what Tina just said. And taking a look, I was going to ask the question to Ken. Is that heart-shaped space like about as big as City Hall? You know, the big open space in front of San Jose City Hall?
Yeah.
No, it's not that big.
I could tell you that when we meet again, I could show you comparable spaces. It's not going to be, I say barren. It's going to have.
It's going to be much better.
Well, it's going to be much better. It's going to be much better. And shade is important. And trees take time to grow, as we all know. So. This idea of having shade structures in some way, and there's a lot of ways to do that. Permanent trellises, there's also ways you can do it in a temporary way until the trees grow up. But definitely this needs to be a space that's soft, comfortable, and, you know, in any condition, in all the seasons, but also it needs to be accommodate a lot of people when they're... So that's kind of the trick of doing this as a designer. And so I just would like to say that we're taking all of this in mind. And tonight, this is an opportunity for us to show you what our initial thinking, but this is not the final thinking. This is going to be refined as we go on and we're going to take input.
Ken, real
briefly,
you know, this is an agricultural heritage here. All of these people work in orchards. And so my thing says to have some sort of preference that the
it's very important. In fact, we've insinuated some cherry groves that are part of this, and I know you have cherry trees in particular on Jackson Street, and we want to make sure that agrarian character as well as the culture and history are blended together. And I think that's a very good remark that you made. And we're going to do our best to combine all those things. It's not as easy as it sounds, but I think we really can. We're going to do this, and tonight was just the beginning. So I thank you all very much.
Matt's going to close really fast.
Okay. I just want to, before we move on to the next piece, I just want to let you know that our team is going to be in the back with the boards here afterwards. So if anyone wants to talk to us informally, have any other specific questions, we can keep chatting until you're exhausted. So thanks.
So I'm going to have Karen Matt come up. She's with DOT. She's going to discuss. I'm going to place a handout at the table. I don't want you to all run for it. I want you to take it as you leave. And she's going to go over what's to come. And also, please be reminded, my email is on the agenda. You can always email me questions, things that you didn't get to ask tonight or that things that pop up later. My business card is over there also. And then on that website, there will be a link to my contact information. So with that, I'll turn it over to Karen Mack.
Good evening. I'm Karen Mack from Public Works. I'm the traffic manager for Development Services. and I review and approve all the traffic reports that are done in the city of San Jose. A traffic analysis was done for this project. By the way, thank you for not asking a lot of questions about traffic. It's quite enjoyable for me. Traffic is next to parking, the next major concern. This project did do a traffic analysis. They've done a few, and this one, the most current one that was done for this project, identified three impacts, significant traffic impacts, I believe it's three, yes, associated with the development of this project. One of the impacts was at the interchanges at 101 Mayberry Oakland Road, and as a result of that impact, the developer will be paying a traffic impact fee that will be used to reconstruct the interchange at Oakland and 101 and an additional interchange at Mayberry 101. The second impact was to the intersection of First and Taylor, which is identified in the city's transportation policy as a protected intersection. Interestingly enough, protected intersections were actually created for Japantown. The city had a desire when working with the community not to make many of the intersections that are walkable any bigger. And so out of that effort, in 2005, the city adopted a provision in their council policy 5-3 that allowed for intersections to be protected. And it just means that they're recognizing that these intersections are multimodal in nature, that they would like to encourage walking, and they don't want to widen them so that it makes it difficult to walk or bike. There are several intersections in Japantown that were identified as protected. This project has an impact at one protected intersection. The policy requires the developer not to build capacity into the intersection, but to build improvements that offset that impact. And what that means is it's creation or the construction of multimodal improvements, neighborhood improvements. And the process for that is that there will be a meeting that will be presented by Department of Transportation with Planning and Public Works, in which we will come to the neighborhood during the planning permit stage, and we'll give you a list of improvements that had been previously identified by your neighborhood, by the council offices, and even the Department of Transportation as things that you might want to see built in your neighborhood. You will have an opportunity to discuss with the developer and city staff how to prioritize those improvements. The map that Leah referred to is on the back table. It's an 11 by 17 map. I'll show it to you real quick. It looks like this, Jackson Taylor Community Improvement Zone.
Can you put that on the slide?
Well, copies back there, so everyone will.
Yeah, there's 50 copies back there. Why we're giving it to you today is not so we can just discuss it, but so that you can take it home, read it, look at it, and be prepared to discuss it at a subsequent meeting. So it takes a little bit of time for a neighborhood to determine what improvements they might like to see. Those improvements are ones that have been previously identified. If you have other things that you would like to see that meet the intent of the policy, the city would consider those also. You just need to bring your information to the meeting that will happen with this. Yes, ma'am?
When is that meeting?
That's a good question. We don't know yet. We will notice accordingly. And like Karen was saying, you can do a write-in vote, basically. So, yes.
The reason why I'm asking is that I'm the president of the Japantown Neighborhood Association, and because we know that developers have to give the city money to mitigate traffic, what my neighborhood doesn't want to see, which is the Japantown Neighborhood Association that scraps Japantown, is we don't want to see 100% of that money to be used for 101 and Mayberry, and I don't think Northside or St. James or Ben Nome would like to see that either. So we are now in the process of conducting a traffic survey. And so I'm looking at your map, and it doesn't take into consideration consideration the neighborhood.
We weren't supposed to discuss the map at this meeting.
Oh,
no. No, I'm just, it's okay.
Okay, so we're doing a study, and with charts and pie charts, and with all the neighborhoods chiming in as to the impact of this development and other developments on the neighborhood. And so I'm hoping the city is collecting all those monies and waiting for the neighborhoods to come and ask for traffic mitigation.
So the process, is that the impacts of the interchange, that is an actual traffic impact fee that must go to mitigate those freeway impacts. This is a separate impact that occurred at a separate intersection.
So they take the developers like...
Developer has a responsibility for two different traffic mitigation scenarios.
Yeah.
One for the interchange and one for protected intersections. That money belongs to the neighborhood. You're absolutely right. The provision for determining how the money is spent is the neighborhood gives input and the city takes it back, and Department of Transportation determines based on the neighborhood impact, based on the neighborhood priority, they determine the budget and also how those improvements and which improvements get constructed. So really, Department of Transportation will review the improvements for feasibility as well, and just make sure that that they can be constructed in a timely manner. So for example, I'll just say this one last thing. We keep talking to the neighborhood about the crossings, the rail crossings. From the city standpoint, it's a concern of ours. We all would love to see the at-grade crossings improve because it improves the bike-ped environment. But when the PUC gets a hold of an application for a permit, the Public Utilities Commission can often use all your money up in studies and ask the other provisions before they give you that permit. So the city is really cautious when they're spending this money, they want to spend it wisely. Yes, ma'am.
I have two questions. My first question is, you had said previously neighborhoods or neighbors have identified things that they'd like to see. I'd like to know who did that and when did that happen?
The original?
Question is, when you did the traffic impact study, are you taking into consideration cumulative effects of other developments in the area, or is it specifically only to this project?
By law, we have to consider all pending development, whether it's under construction, whether it's approved but not yet built, or it's reasonably foreseeable, so a piece of land that doesn't have anything on it. So the traffic report looks at all of those things and layers the projected amount of traffic to come up with this traffic scenario. So yes, and secondly, your question about where the original list came up from was the S&I effort that the city did. So the Strong Neighborhood Initiatives came out to your neighborhoods, and the lists were developed from the neighborhoods. They were wish lists of different improvements. So that's where the original list came from.
The original traffic improvement lists were created in 1998 as part of the Jackson-Taylor specific plan. So if you grab that map on your way out, you'll see some are like already considered improvements. Some are ones that we've thought of but haven't been through that sort of process. But we're up for any ideas.
Yeah, and actually, in 2007, the council adopted a list that was based on the S&I and Jackson Taylor. Many of those improvements have been built, the traffic circles and some other things, bulb outs in the neighborhoods surrounding these areas. So we just keep adding to the list as the council office and the neighborhoods express concerns and desires to the Department of Transportation.
Take one more question, because the specifics, if you've gone up and got a map, we don't want to talk about specifics. We're going to have a second meeting, I promise. So if you have general questions about what we expect from you for the next meeting, we'll entertain those questions.
Just one really basic question. If you're a senior citizen with a walker at Fuji Tower,
with 532 new units, with all the traffic, are you still going to be able to safely cross to go to Santo Market and get back to Towers Alive?
So one of the things about creating small streets is it, we hope, puts cars where they should be, which is on larger streets. That's why the city invests in the lands around interchanges, because we still want cars to go to those interchanges, and we don't want them to drive through neighborhood streets. This traffic analysis looked at this 600 residential units and was, there's always, from the neighborhood standpoint, an impact when there's any change, any increase in traffic, doesn't matter how big or how small. So it's the city's goal to balance any new development versus what's there existing on the street, and hopefully get a reasonable balance between what the city thinks is an impact and what a neighborhood thinks is an impact. It's usually two separate things, but you can look at the, and I'd be glad to talk you through it, the transportation policies on how the city reviews traffic. Secondly, I guess in closing, I would say that one of the things that will help is you can always, with your protected intersection money, you can identify areas where there are pedestrian improvements. You can identify areas where you might want more handicap ramps. And those things are things that you can fund with your protected intersection money, and that makes your walking environment much better.
Can we save it for small group breakout?
Is this plaza going to have a curfew like the rest of
the
town?
Good question. So residential businesses are allowed by right to be open until midnight. It's their choice to close earlier than that. A lot of them close between lunch and dinner, which I may or may not appreciate, but it is what it is.
I eat late.
So, parks, Mary Beth, hi. Do parks have curfews where they close at dusk or at some other time? That seems to have run lights out-ish around him. So we will have more community meetings. You will get notices. We really hope you guys come so that we can flush out the rest of the details as this project evolves. Thank you all so much, neighbors, for coming tonight.